Yes, good morning everyone. So today we'll see about special function register. So in the previous video we have seen the functional block diagram and we learnt about each block, how it works. Then we have studied about memory organization of 8051, RAM, ROM, internal ROM, external RAM and external ROM. So today we will see SFRs, special function registers. So we already know about accumulator, register B, where do we use, at what operations we use those registers and all. So see here, at 80, at this location you have port 0. Next at 80 you have port 0. Then 81 you have stack pointer. Then 82 and 83 you have DPTR. So 82 is of 8-bit, 83 of 8-bit. So DPH and DPL. Now next you have, this is power control. PCON is nothing but power control, timer and counter control. This is timer and counter mode control. Then see, this all are timer and counters. So this TL0 and TH0, that means 8A and 8C are of timer 0, because there is TL0 and TH0. So timer 0's, TL0 is lower order bits, whereas TH0 is higher order bits of timer 0. And coming to 8B, this 8B and 8D, this is of timer 1. So timer 1 is of 16 bit, timer 0 is of 16 bit. So in this we have timer, this is T, timer 1's lower order bits, and this is timer 1's higher order bits. Next we have is, here we have at 90 location port 1. Then SCON is nothing but serial controls, for serial port control. Next, this is for a serial buffer. BUF is nothing but buffer. This is again port 2. You have IE here and IP here. So IE is nothing but your interrupt enable. IP is interrupt priority. Next, at B0 you have port 3. At A0 port 2, yeah, B0 port 3. Next, this both are accumulator and register B. So these are all special function registers which are placed above the RAM location, that is, it starts from 80H. So today we will learn about each register. First, before going to that, we will see ports. How are they? I said all the ports are of 8 bit size. So we will just see. Yeah, these are 4 ports of 8051. Now according to this port, see, first you have is port 0, that is of 8 bit. So port 0 is starts from 80H, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86 and 87. So these are of port 0. So whenever I want to write, send 00, 0 into, if I write in decimal form, that will be 0. If I write in the form of hexadecimal form, that will be 00H. So when I want to load this 00H into this port 0, how I need to write this? I can write move. MOV is the instruction to move this 00H into port 0. So I can write move P0, comma, this is immediate addressing mode, 00H. If I write this, what happens is this 00H will be moved into P0. That means here at 80 location you will have 0. These are bits, each bit 0 and 1s, right? So this hexa will be converted into binary whenever it is moving into this port. All bits will become zeros. That means here I just moved 0 into port 0. In case if I want to move 1, if I want to move 1, then here I can write here I can write 01. When I write 01 in this port, it will be loaded as, this will be loaded as 1. That means now port 0 is loaded with 01H. Okay, so in this way I can load the values into port, and all these ports are bit addressable. So whenever I say bit addressable, instead of writing, see now if I want to make this as 3, if I want to make the, I want to load port 0 with 3, then what can I do is, the instruction for that, instead of this instruction, now already port 0 is loaded with 1, but now I want to make it 3. So I can for 3, what is the what are the values I can change at the place of p 0.1? see, at p 0.0 you already have 1. So if I play, if I have at p 0.1, if I have 1, that means the complete value will turn into 3. So instead of loading the complete 8 bit value, what will I do is, I'll just do this individually. Only this bit I'll try to manipulate, I mean I'll send only 1 into this p 0.1. for that you have separate instruction, that is set b p 0.1, okay, that is a point this is 0.1. if you write this instruction, that means it automatically, only this one bit will be manipulated as 1. In case instead of writing this bit, instead of writing this, if I instead of writing this, if I make this as 3 here, before it was 1. Before it was 1 here. So instead of writing this, if I directly write here 03H, if I write instead of set B P 0.1, if I write move P0 comma ash 03H, then what is going to happen is, instead of this one bit being changed, before if I write set B, this only this was erased. So now this complete thing will be loaded again. That means this complete port 0 will be loaded, because you are loading the P0. P0 means complete port. So again the complete port will become 0, 0, 0, 0, then 0 again, 0, 1 and 1. So this is the main difference between what is bit addressable and byte addressable. If I use P0, that is byte, I am addressing using byte. If I am just writing set B, and if I am changing only one bit, that is called bit addressable. I can manipulate only one bit. So this port 0 is by default, it all are like byte addressable, but this also has the thing like it is a bit addressable. Okay. So same way you have port 1, port 2 and port 3. So same way all are bit addressable, each has its own addresses. So after port 3, yeah. Yesterday we have seen about this PSW register, okay, program status word. This is also called as flag register. So in this first we have seen, yesterday we have seen what is RS0 and RS1. See here, whenever I place this RS0 and this RS1, this in from these two bits, whenever I write, I make this 0 and 0, that means register bank in internal RAM 0 will be selected. See, register bank 0 is selected, and whenever I make it as 0 and 1, bank 1 will be selected. whenever I make it as 1 and 0, bank 2 will be selected. And whenever I make it as 1 and 1, bank 3 will be selected. In this way, I can select the bank which I wanted from the internal RAM. But by default, it always has bank 0. So now, apart from this, you have the other bits. We'll just go through other bits. In the other bits here, first you have parity. P is nothing but parity. Then this is user defined flag. This is user defined flag. And then this is overflow flag. This is overflow. And these two bits we just saw, this is for register bank selection. And this F0 is this is of general purpose flag. Then AC is auxiliary carry flag and CY is carry flag. So see, whenever you are doing some arithmetic and logical operations, what happens is you get a result. Whenever after processing, you'll get some result. So whenever you get that result, what happens is you will get in the form of binary bits, that is zeros and ones. So whenever you get in result, whenever you get odd number of ones, then this parity will be in set condition. That means this, in this D0 bit, you will get 1. So by looking at that 1, we will understand that in the result, I have odd number of ones. Okay, in case instead of 1, if I have 0 here, I have 0, that means in my result I had even number of ones. Is that fine? So it is telling us the status of that result. How many number of ones are there in my last answer, I mean the result. So by checking this status, I can know what is the result, how many number of ones, whether they are odd number of ones or even number of ones. Generally, this we'll use it in while doing a programs like normal small programs like to find out to rotate whenever I wanted to rotate. Okay, in such programs also we can use this. You have, after parity bit, you have user defined flag. Yeah, next overflow. This overflow this overflow flag becomes 1 whenever you have a carry from 7th bit or 6th bit at a time. Both bits can't have a carry. Okay, so whenever you have a carry at 7th bit, this will become 1. If it's not having a carry at 7th bit, but it is having a carry at 6th bit of your result, then also it will show you 1. But if you don't have a carry from 6th or 7th bit, then it will be in reset condition, that is 0. Okay, so by checking this condition 0 or 1, we can easily know whether the number what we have got after multiplication, whatever we have got, it is a bigger number or smaller number. Then this both banks we have seen, that is 00, bank 0 is selected. If it is 0 and 1, here you have 0 and 1, then bank 1 is selected. If you have 1 and 0, bank 2 is selected. If you have 1 and 1, bank 3 is selected, in that way. Yeah, this F0 is general purpose flag. Next you have AC. This auxiliary carry is nothing but in your operations, whenever you do, in the while doing the operations from A and B, if you try to add A and B and if you get a carry at for example in 8 bit, if you get a carry from 3rd bit to 4th bit, okay, whenever you get a carry at this place, nothing but if you have 1 1 1 and 1, so this is complete 8 bit number. If you get a carry from here to here, that means from this nibble to here, then this will be 1. If there is no carry between these two bits, D3 and D4, then this will always be in reset condition. So by looking at this auxiliary carry, whether the flag is raised or not, depending on that, we can say is there any carry from nibble from D3 bit to D4 bit to D3. Next you have is carry flag. CY is nothing but your carry flag. So at this carry flag, same time of the operations, whenever you get a carry at only this 7th bit, okay, whenever you get a carry at 7th bit, if you take LSB from here, this will be a 7th bit. Generally the orientation what we write is, here it you will have LSB and here it starts an MSB. So this will be a 7th bit if you in this way. So whenever you get a carry over here at your 7th bit, that means this will be in set condition, okay. And if you don't get any carry at D7th bit, then this will be in reset condition. So by checking at this carry, if you have one, that means you got a carry. If your flag carry flag is 0, that means it is in reset condition, then you didn't get any carry at D7th bit. So you can easily have all the status of your result, whatever you got. So it is called program status word or flag register. So in this program status word, overall you have 4 conditional flags, okay. Those are nothing but carry flag, auxiliary carry, overflow, parity. Next you have 2 register banks, that is RS1 and RS0. Then you have one user defined flag and one general purpose flag, that is F0. Okay. Now next, after this, what you have is, we'll move on to timers and counters. So in this timers and what are actually timers and counters? We already have seen you have 2 timers or counters, each is of 16 bit size. So it can be programmed independently as a timer or counter. What I meant to say is the same timer can be used as counter also. Okay, so when one timer is being used as a counter, same can't be used as a timer. Either it can be used as a timer or a counter. Okay, so the operations, I mean the SFRs related to this timer and counter, overall you have these 4 things. One is timer 0, timer 1. Timer 0 means here you have at timer 0 here you have TH0 and TL0. Okay, next timer 1 you have TL1 and TH1. That means 16 bit is divided into 2 8 bit registers, lower bits and higher bits. Next you have TMOD and TCON. So we will see all these. Now see, this timer is divided into 2 timers. You have 2 timers in 8051, timer T0 and T1. This T0 is of 16 bit size. This is also of 16 bit size. So this 16 bit is divided into, 16 bit timer is divided into 8 bit TH0. This is 8 bit timer 0, that is TL0. Then this 16 bit timer 1 is divided into 2 8 bit timers, that is 8 bit TL timer 1 lower bits and timer 1 higher bits. In this way, so we will see how generally it looks. Yeah, see, now this is timer 0. So see, at timer 0, when you see the timer 0, you have total 16 bits. So D0, D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6, D7. If you consider 8 bit, then TL0. These are 8 bit lower bits of TL0. Then next after D7, D8, D9 up to D15, higher bits of timer 0. So next timer 1's lower bits and higher bits. Okay, so complete 16 bit register, 16 bit timer 0, 16 bit timer 1. And whenever you try to load in it, generally what does the timer do? It generates some delay. So whenever you want to generate a delay, you will try to add count values into this. It will also act like a counter. So whenever it is doing that counting part, what we actually do is, if I want to create some delay, a delay, generally the count value is calculated by the by having the frequency, the clock frequency value. Okay, so in the by you have some formulas for that in I'll that we have in our last chapter, so we'll go through that later. So for example, for your minimum understanding, I want to tell you is if I want to have 10 counts, okay, for 10 counts it is creating some amount of delay. We'll take a delay as x. Okay, so till that for that x delay I am having 10 counts. So whenever this timer will start to count 10, so that means in this if I am taking this timer 0, I need to load this value with 10. Okay, convert into 10, convert it into bits, binary bits. So what happens, all this all will become 0 0 0 complete this time 0. Then here what will I load? 1 0 1 0 0 0 0 0. So in this way I'll load my timer. Okay, so whenever I load this timer, that means if I write it in hexa form, how will I load this 0 0 0 a h? Okay, in hexa, if I convert into hexa, that will become 0 0 0 a h. So whenever I load this timer with a h, so it should count now. It will start to count from 10, then 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and will go back to 0. By default, before this was 0. It started counting downwards and it became 0, 0. Okay, so 10, 9, 8, before here in this counter I had 10, okay, here I had 1, 0, 1, 0, then 9, then 8, then 7, in that way you will count up to 2, 1, 0, so it will reach to 0, that means whenever this is reaching to 0, okay, that is called rollover condition. So whenever it reaches 0, what it does is that count, I mean that counting of a timer is disabled. The timer is disabled. Whenever the this timer and counter is disabled, the counting stops. That means it has created the x delay what I wanted to give. So same way, if I wanted to have some y delay, for y delay also I need to calculate the number of counts, okay, the count value. When I have the count value, take my count value, what I got is 20. Now instead of 10, I am taking 20. So always I should load the timer with the maximum value only. The timer and counter never counts from 0, 1, 2 in this way. Upwards it never counts. It this counter always counts downwards. So whatever counts you wanted to do, take that maximum value and load into this counter. So whenever you count, it will count. If you take a 20 value, then it will count 19, 18 and so on up to it should reach this condition, zero, overflow condition. So whenever it reaches this condition, that means this counter will be automatically disabled. Is that fine? So in this way, if instead of timer 0, I can also use timer 1. Okay, anything, both works in a same way. So this is how this timer works. So now you have TMOD register. So this TMOD register, what it does is, first what is TMOD register, that is timer and counter mode control. So in this timer and counter mode control, this is of 8 bit SFR, okay, and it is generally for these two timers, T0 and T1. See, here I have T0, this is for T0 and this is for T1, total 8 bits, right? In this, 4 bits are for timer 0, then this 4 bits are for timer 1. Okay, so this 4 bits of timer 0, we'll see first. See, you have here, you have M0, M1, this both are nothing but the modes. Okay, to you have M0 and M1. By writing the values of M0 and M1, which mode it is the timer is operating, the timer 0. If you write this M0 and M1 of timer 0, timer 0 will act in generally 4 modes. This timer can act in 4 modes. Let it be timer 0 or timer 1.
So which mode it is acting, we wanted to know that. To know that, we need to load M0 and M1. Whatever mode we wanted the timer to be enabled, so that mode can be activated by using M0 and M1. That mode can be selected by using M0 and M1. Then this C by T bar actually, okay, T, this is C by T bar. So now what this do is, whenever I make this bit as 1, okay, whenever I make this bit as 1, the timer 0 will act like a counter, okay, event counters. If I make this C by T bar is equal to 0, this timer 0 will act like a timer. Is that fine? So whenever I make that C by T bit here, okay, this third bit in this timer 0, if I make that as 0, it will work like a timer. If I make it as 1, it will work like a counter. Next, you have another one is gate. Gate is nothing but the controlling of a timer. What it does is, this is a main bit which controls the timer 0, because this gate is of timer 0. If you take this gate, this will control timer 1. But when I talk about this, this will control, this bit will control this timer 0. So how it controls? This timer can be enabled by using two methods. One is hardware method and software method. Okay, hardware method means in the pin diagram of 8051, you have INT0 and INT1 bar pins, these two pins externally. So this timer 0 can be controlled by using those INT0 and INT1 pins. If I control using those pins by making it high, by making it high or low by there, that means that is called hardware method of controlling. So whenever I want to control using hardware method, I should make gate as 1. Whenever I write gate as 1, it will always control timer using this INT0 and INT1. Okay. Next, software method. Whenever I want to control my timer using software method, I should write gate as 0. But how it controls? I said hardware controlling method is nothing but, first of all, to enable my timer 0, I have two methods. I can enable using hardware, I can enable using software. Hardware method means I should first make here 1. After making it as 1, hardware how to control? By going to that pins in pin diagram of 8051, we have studied INT0 and INT1 bar pins, active low pins were there, okay, at port 3. So by using those pins, I can control this timer 0, which is called hardware controlling. Now coming to software, whenever I want to control this timer, I mean enable or disable this timer using software method, first this gate should be made 0, this bit should be made 0. Then how will I control this software method is, here we have two, TMOD and TCON, right? So see, this is TCON. In this TCON, I have this bit, TR0. So this is very much responsible for software controlling of timer. So we'll see that when we come to this TCON. So software method means we can on and off this timer 0 by making gate as 0. And so software method means, I said, we need to, in a TCON register, you have a bit called R0. TR0 means for timer 0. Okay, TR1 means for timer 1. So whenever I make this bit as 1, then in software manner, I'll make my timer 0 in on condition. And if I make this as 0, TR0 as 0, then timer 0 to stop, I can control it in a software method. So in the software method, I can either on or off by making TR1 as 1 or 0. So this also, that is only one bit, right? TR0 is one bit. That means for always bit operations, to make it as 1, I should write set B T R naught. To make it as 0, I should write clear. C L R, clear. T R naught. Okay, if I write in that way, that means if I write set B T R naught, I'm just making 1 in T R naught. Okay, that means I'm oning timer 0 in software method. If I write CLR, that is clear TR0 in TCON register. So I'm trying to off this timer. That is called software method. So now you have mode 0 and mode 1. Okay, so mode 0 and mode 1. See here you have modes. M0, M1 bits are used to set timer mode. Okay, you have 4 modes. If you make 0 and 0. That means mode 0 is you wanted to make this timer to be operated in mode 0. Mode 0 means it is 13 bit timer. Okay, so we are coming to mode 1. If you place at M1 0 and at M1 M0 1, then your timer 0 is operated in mode 1. That is 16 bit timer. Okay. So that means 13 bit timer here means your TL lower bits you will have only 5 bits, whereas higher bits you have 8. Okay, so in this 13 bits your timer, the count value should be loaded and that will count downwards. Whenever you get 0 rollover condition, we call it as rollover condition. Okay, so it will automatically make TF. You will have some flags in TCON again that will make to in set condition, so that we will see later. First just see what are these modes for. So mode 1 is for 16 bits. Mode 2 is for 8 bit auto reload mode. So this auto reload mode is nothing but see this 8 bit counter overflow from TL not only sets the TF but it also reloads TL with the content of TH. Whatever were there in TH, it uses only 8 bit, but timer is of 16 bit, right, complete. So what it does is it will auto reload, automatically it will try to reload from TL to TH. The contents whatever are there in TH will be reloaded into TL. Then again it will start to count back. Next split timer mode. Then you have a split mode where in real timer you generally use timer 0, that is TL naught and TH naught. Okay. Next you have is before going to modes, yeah. So now here we have seen by making this 00, mode 0 will be selected for timer 0, and here by making this 1 or 0, timer or counter, whether it is acting like a timer or a counter, we'll decide. Then by making it as 1 or 0, I am trying to on the timer using hardware or software. Okay, if it is hardware, INT0 and INT1 are the pins responsible. When I use software, TCON is responsible. Okay, TCON register, in TCON register you have a bit called TR. Okay, so that bit is responsible to on and off a timer in software method. So whenever I do all these, I am only responsible for timer 0. Now same way, if I want to select a mode of timer 1, here I need to select the bit. So if I make 1 here, this is 0 and 1, mode 1 is selected for timer 1. Okay, now here if I make it as 0 and here if I make it as 1, what it means? It means I selected mode 1 for this timer 1 and this timer is being acting like a timer itself, not counter. If I make it as 1, it will act like a counter. So I made here this is 0, that means it is acting like a timer and that is being enabled by hardware method. Okay, but in case if I try to write the here 1 and 1, okay, and here if I write 1 and here if I write 0, so what does it means? And here all I make zeros or ones, whatever, yeah. Now timer 1 is operating in the mode of mode 3, that is split mode, whereas C by T, that means it is acting like a counter, not like a timer, acting like a counter, and it is being controlled by software method. Is that fine? So same way, whenever you wanted to operate timer 0, these bits you will fill, I mean these bits need to be selected. Then for timer 1, these bits. So always this complete, if you are using timer 1, in this what bits are there, it is not necessary because we are using timer 0. So this in timer 1, whatever they are, we are not using. So whatever bits are there in that, it is not required. But you need to fill or complete this TMOD register. This is of 8 bit size. Okay. So in today's class, we have seen special function registers, its addresses, where are they located and all. We have seen these ports, all the ports and how to load the value into ports, byte addressable and bit addressable. Okay, if you want to manipulate only one bit, then you should take set B instruction. If you want to clear, instead of making, if you wanted to make one, then you need to write set. If you wanted to clear that, you need to write CLR. Okay, these are the instructions. Next, all four ports. Then we have seen PSW, the flag register, and it how it selects the register banks. Then timer and counters. In this, we have today we have seen about this timer one, timer zero, timer one. Then TMOD. We have seen these things. So in the next video, we will see about TCON and some other SFRs. Thank you.